Program today is the following. We want to first prove the switching lemma, and then we are going to dive into the classification of Gibbs states, invariant Gibbs states. Okay, so first thing, we prove the switching lemma, which I just remind you. So the switching lemma is saying that the sum, if I take sum on two currents, one with sources A and one with sources B, of f of n1 plus n2 w beta n1 w beta n2, this is equal to the same sum where all the sources are on the first guy, of f of n1 plus n2, w beta n1, w beta n2, except that we need to add the indicator function that the trace of n1 plus n2 is in fb. And really think of b as being xy, and we just need to add that x needs to be connected to y in n1 plus n2. There was a slight generalization that we will use, which is that if you take two graphs and then n1 is in g and this is in h, in h and in g, then you are still allowed to switch. It's just that this needs to be true in g when you restrict the graph to g, when you restrict the currents to g. So you don't need to have the same graph. The first one can be bigger than the second one. In fact, I'm just going to prove the one where g is equal to h, and I'm going to leave the other one to you just to check whether you understood. So one remark before we prove this lemma is an interpretation of a current. So a current n can be interpreted as a multigraph. Let's call it n ronde, defined as follows. Simply what you do is you have your vertices of your graph. And if the, so you have your, let's say, these are the vertices. And if you have, say, n e1 equal 1, n e2 equal 2, n e3 equal 0, n e4 equal 0, 5 equal 0, and n e6 equal 6, maybe that's a lot, 4. Then, so this is n, the multigraph associated to it will be simply the graph where you put as many edges between vertices as n. So here you put two of them. You still have the same set of vertices as before. So you may, by the way, have isolated vertices. This is completely possible. And here you put four. Okay? This will be the multigraph associated to n. And this is going to be useful for the proof. C'est parti. So let's take this guy. Let's say the guy on the left. And let's rewrite it. So what is good in both quantities here and here is that the sum of the two currents is the same object. It's a current with sources A symmetric difference B, right? So I'm gonna rewrite the two terms in terms of the sum of the two currents. So I'm gonna make the change of variable n equal n1 and m equal n1 plus n2. Or maybe n equal n2, actually. So when I redo this, I get the sum over currents M, which associates asymmetric difference with B. I get F of M. This product here, I'm going to rewrite it in a slightly different way. I'm going to say this is W beta of M. Okay. Times, well, I have the sum for N smaller or equal to M. The sources of N is B. And here I have, well, W beta of N, W beta of M minus N, W beta of N. Right? That's a trivial change of variable. But the good thing about it is that these terms, this term here, has a nice interpretation. So if you think about this, well, many things cancel. First thing, the beta to the power, so these guys are, remember maybe here, I'm going to put it, W beta of N is a product over the edges of beta to the NE divided by NE factorial, right? That was the definition of my weight. So notice that here, all the beta to the NE disappears. Right, they all cancel each other, because for each edge, you get beta to the NE times beta to the ME minus NE divided by beta to the ME. So the only thing that remains here is the product of edges of, well, in fact, NE choose ME. But this is also, imagine that you have your graph M, your multigraph M. This is also the number of ways of choosing for every pair of vertices you have ME edges between them. It's the number of ways of choosing NE edges among these ME edges. So this whole thing here has a combinatorial interpretation. It has a combinatorial interpretation that this is the number of ways of finding a subgraph of M called N with sources B. Right? So this is exactly equal. So the red thing, let me erase that. So the orange thing as a whole is the number of ways, number of N included in M, such that the boundary of N is equal to B, where here you understand what I mean boundary of a graph, I mean the vertices which have odd degree in this graph. Okay? So to summarize, the first term is equal to the sum for dirons M equal asymmetric difference with B, F of M, W beta of M. And here I have the number of ways of choosing N included in M. This is equal to that. Okay? If I start from the bottom and I do the same thing. So if I start from there, and I do the same thing, well, this is going to be equal to the sum. I redo the same change of variable. Here again, the sum of the two currents have sources asymmetric difference with B. I get F of M, I get W beta of M, I get indicator function that M is in FB, I let you check that the fact that this the trace of my current is in FB is actually equivalent to the fact that N1 plus N2 is in NB. There is no problem with that. Is in FB. So the fact that really this guy is in MB. Actually, let's put it like that. And then I get a term of this type, but notice that here the second current is sourceless. So here the combinatorial quantity I'm gonna get is a number of subset of M which are sourceless this time. Okay? So if I want to prove the lemma, I need to prove that these two things are equal. Okay? For any graph M, are these two things equal? Okay. So how can we prove that these two things are equal? Let's start by something simple. If M doesn't satisfy FB. So if M is not in FB, well, remember I gave you as an exercise that FB was actually equivalent to saying that there exists a subgraph of my graph which set of sources is B. Okay? So if you are not in FB, that means that there are no subsets here with sources B. So if M is not in FB, well, the first and the second terms are equal to zero. The first one because of the fact that you are not in FB, the second one because of the indicator function. So you get zero equals zero and you are happy. So the only difficulty is if F is in FB, if M is in FB. So in this case, by definition, you know that there is a subset of M, there is a subgraph of M, which has sources B. How can you prove that there are as many guys without sources as guys with sources B? Well, there is a simple way to prove that two sets have the same cardinality, you just exhibit a bijection between them. Okay? Well, here there is a natural bijection. You pick this graph, let's call it K, which has sources boundary of B, which has sources B, and you just take the map which maps N to N symmetric difference with K. So pick K subset of N with boundary of K equal B. This you can just by definition of FB. And then the map, which goes from the set N included in M, so that the sources is B, into the set N included in M, so that the set of sources is empty. N gives N symmetric difference K, really in terms of graphs, the symmetric difference. So it's just the set of edges is the symmetric difference between the set of edges of N and the set of edges of K. This is the definition of N symmetric difference K. Well, this is an involution. Is an involution. So in particular, it's bijective. And therefore, the two sets have the same cardinality. Okay? That's the end of the proof. There are a bunch of other proofs of this lemma. I mean, this one is maybe the simplest one, so that's why I chose it. Okay, so there is something very combinatorial behind the scene, like playing here, and it's maybe not that intuitive, but the consequences of that will be huge. Okay, I think that that's the end of this lecture, basically. I mean, not today's lecture, but I mean of lecture four. And now we can go to lecture five on the classification of infinite volume Gibbs states. Are there questions on the proof? No. Maybe just to conclude this, just one exercise to conclude this lecture, try to prove Simon inequality using random current. Let's say, first question, prove that this I kind of proved yesterday, but prove that this thing, not yesterday, but on Tuesday, prove that this is equal to the probability if in the first current you put 0x and in the second current empty set of y is connected to 0. Okay, so you remember this is a law where you pick one current with sources 0x at random. Okay? And this is the law where you pick one sourceless current at random. So try to prove these things. This is a consequence of the switching lemma, and I think I even proved it on Tuesday. And second thing, try to prove Simon inequality. Using this fact. Okay, so lecture five. Classification of invariant Gibbs states. So our goal now is to say, well, we constructed the plus, the minus, and the free Gibbs states. The goal is to prove that if you take your Gibbs state, which a priori, remember, that was just this thing having the DLR condition, having just this domain Markov property. If I take one Gibbs state like that, which is invariant at the translation, then it has to be, in fact, a convex combination of mu plus and, I mean, of the plus and minus states. Remember the definition of the plus states, the minus states. And for this lecture, in order to simplify a little bit, since we are going to use another Gibbs states, which we will call just bracket beta, I will define the free state as this thing with the superscript 0. Okay, this is the limit when n tends to infinity of lambda n beta, so I mean without superscript. You take the measure in the box of size n and you take the limit. Okay? Remember that those are obtained from the Edwards-Sokal coupling from phi 1, from the random cluster, from the FK Ising model with wired boundary condition, while this one is obtained from the FK Ising model with free boundary condition, the phi 0. This is obtained from phi 1, this is obtained from phi 0. Okay. So, first theorem, which goes back to Leibovitz, even though we are is to say that if sigma x sigma y plus beta is equal to sigma x sigma y 0 beta for every edge E equals XY. So for, if, imagine for every edge, you have that the free and the plus states have the same correlations for the endpoints, then there exists exactly two, or let's say every, then every Gibbs states which is invariant under translations is a convex combination of mu plus, I mean of the plus states and the minus states. Okay? So that means that you cannot construct some kind of exotic Gibbs state that will be different from the linear combination of the plus and minus states. Notice maybe two remarks. What does this theorem implies on the free state? Well, it does imply that it's the average of the plus and minus states because it's symmetric. So this is just 1/2 of plus beta plus 1/2 of the minus beta. Okay? But it also implies that the other ones are all convex combinations. So what does this thing boils down to when you look at the FK-Ising model? When you look at the FK-Ising model, this whole thing implies that phi 1 p is equal to phi 0 p. Okay? So in some sense, this theorem is already quite useful. Why? Because we did prove that phi 1 was equal to phi 0 for almost every p. So that means that for almost every beta, this is going to be automatic. And that means that for almost every beta, we will have uniqueness of the Gibbs states that are invariant under translation. Okay? The next, I'm going to prove this theorem. The second part of the lecture will be to actually prove that this is true for every p, not just for all, but finitely, but countably many p's. Okay, so let's prove this. So it's going to take a little bit of time. That starts to be like really non-trivial theorem. So we have to go slowly. So step one, it's going to be to prove that if you have a state, assume that sigma x, sigma y for a certain Gibbs state. So pick a Gibbs state. Okay, maybe I should write better, sorry. I mean, in the whole proof, so pick beta a Gibbs state invariant under translations. Okay. This will be our Gibbs states. Not to confuse with the free state, again. So step one is going to be to say, for every x and y in, for every xy in E of the D, sigma x, sigma y beta is equal to sigma x sigma y plus beta. So I'm gonna, this is just saying if it's equal for the free state, then it's equal for any Gibbs state which is invariant of the translation. Okay? So this in fact we already did the proof. I'm just gonna sketch it, but in some sense, somewhere in the lecture, there was something that is proving that. And this somewhere was the following. So assume, I mean, we are going to prove something slightly weaker, which is that sigma x, sigma y, beta is larger or equal to sigma x, sigma y, beta prime plus for every beta prime smaller than beta. And that should remind you of something that we did for FKZing, which was that we proved at some point that the probability of being open for wired boundary condition and p prime smaller than p was smaller than the probability of being open at p for phi zero. At the same value, they can differ, and they differ in the other way, but definitely if you are at the with free boundary condition, your probability of being open is larger than any wired before, like for p prime smaller than p. This is exactly the same thing, except that we are with an arbitrary Gibbs state, we are not with phi zero. Before I prove that, notice that it does imply this for the following reason, which is that, okay, maybe the first thing that one should check is that this is always smaller or equal to that. So this, we will prove that later. Now let's prove how it implies this. Well, first thing is that sigma x, sigma y, beta, you can always write it as the average of sigma x, sigma y in a certain box, say lambda n, beta, for some boundary condition tau, which is a random random variable, which is simply the law, which has the law of the boundary spins under my Gibbs state. This is just using the DLR condition, the domain Markov property. So tau, if you take somebody which has the law of the, here I could put sigma restricted to the boundary of lambda n. That's actually lambda n plus 1 if we are very careful. So you can always write like that. And here we have monotonicity in boundary conditions. So this is always smaller or equal to sigma x, sigma y, lambda n beta plus. So you know that the average of sigma x, sigma y, beta is always smaller or equal to sigma x, sigma y plus lambda n beta when n tends to infinity. That implies that sigma x, sigma y, beta is always smaller or equal to sigma x, sigma y plus beta. So this is always true. So in some sense, we hope that this is going to give me what? That it's going to give us exactly that sigma x, sigma y, beta is always larger or equal to sigma x, sigma y, beta 0. Right? So why is it true? Now, if sigma x, sigma y, beta is larger than sigma x, sigma y, beta prime plus, then it's larger than this for every beta prime, then it's larger than the supremum of a beta prime smaller than beta of sigma x, sigma y plus beta prime. Okay? If it's true for every beta prime smaller than beta, it's larger than the supremum. But notice that by the uniqueness almost everywhere of phi 0 and phi 1, this supremum here is the same as the supremum with zero boundary condition here. Simply because whatever the beta prime smaller than beta that you are taking, there will be a beta double prime between beta prime and beta, for which phi 0 is equal to phi 1. But that implies that the plus states is the average of the free states. And therefore, that sigma 0, sigma y, 0, is equal to sigma 0, sigma y plus. Because sigma 0, sigma x, sigma y plus and sigma x, sigma y minus are equal. So here, this is by uniqueness. Phi 0 equal phi 1 p for all but countably many. Okay, and when you have that, of course, you have that. Which gives that sigma x, sigma y, 0 beta equals sigma x, sigma y plus beta. Okay, so you can replace by 0. But now, notice that if you want, the zero state is continuous from below. In the sense that this supremum, I want to prove that it's just equal to the average of sigma x, sigma y, zero at beta. But this can easily be deduced from the fact that this is also the supremum over n of sigma x, sigma y, lambda n beta prime. And the zero in finite volume is useless. Sigma x, sigma, the average of sigma x, sigma y is a probability in the random cluster model that x is connected, I'm going to do simpler than that. We did prove that the spin-spin correlations are increasing in the graph. So this guy here is the supremum of these guys. But now, good for us, supremums do commute, so this is the supremum over n of the supremum of a beta prime smaller than beta of sigma x, sigma y, lambda n beta prime. This is sigma x, sigma y, lambda n beta, because we are in finite volume, so the supremum of a beta prime smaller than beta give me exactly what I get at beta. And the supremum over n gives me sigma x, sigma y, beta 0. Okay? So this is always true, the bound by the plus states, and this is always true if I prove these things. So assuming that sigma x, sigma y, beta is always sandwiched between the plus and the zero states. So if they are equal, then at least I would have proved this thing. Okay? Yes?
What we are going to prove is with the zero.
No, with the plus, because it's...
Here?
No. Here it's this guy, right? It's the Gibbs state. That I prove here, using this property, I prove that it's larger than this one. Okay? So overall, here what I proved, these two things together, I did prove that sigma x, sigma y, beta is smaller than sigma x, sigma y, beta 0, and it's plus, sorry. And it's larger than sigma x, sigma y, beta 0. Okay?
So step one, you prove it after you. The step one, you prove it equal to.
No, but that implies step one. I mean, that's my assumption is that these two states are equal, right? So that concludes step one. No, it was good to remind, right? I mean, this is our assumption. So once we are here, we did prove step one. Okay. So let's now try to prove this thing. So this, as I said, we already proved, except we prove in the case of the random cluster model. So let me just sketch extremely briefly how we prove it here. So you state A to be, say, sigma x, sigma y, beta plus, and B equals sigma x, sigma y, beta. Okay? So remember that beta prime is smaller than beta. So my goal is to prove that A is smaller or equal to B. Okay? And I do the same thing. I pick epsilon and so on. And I say that, well, epsilon is smaller or equal to the probability for the plus state to have H of sigma, the Hamiltonian, larger than A minus epsilon times the number of edges in my box of size n. Okay? This is exactly like saying the probability that the number of open edges in my box is larger or equal to blah blah. It's exactly the same thing, so it's just a consequence of the domain Markov property. So this is clearly smaller than the same thing. I mean, so now I'm going to rewrite. This was in beta prime. I'm going to rewrite it in beta. And remember that the trick was to use that there is a Radon-Nikodym derivative between the two, which is quite explicit. So here I'm going to keep this thing. Okay? And then I'm going to put a e to the beta prime minus beta, edge of sigma, beta plus, and I divide it by e to the beta prime minus beta, edge of sigma, beta plus. Okay, that's maybe a beta minus beta prime. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so maybe you want to be working in lambda n here. Let's put lambda n. Okay. Good remark, thank you. Okay, so now here, notice that exactly because of this property that you can always average correlations with when you take your infinite Gibbs states, you can average correlations with respect and you get some random boundary condition. Whatever this random boundary condition, the cost to your Radon-Nikodym derivative will be at most e to the beta times the size of the boundary. Because in one case you have plus boundary condition, in the other one you may have plus or minus boundary condition at a vertex. But since you have at most size of the boundary, number of vertices on the boundary, here I can bound by e maybe to the 2 beta times the size of the boundary times the same thing with mu, the same thing with the Gibbs states. Okay? Okay. Well, here now you just use that for this Gibbs state, the e to the beta minus beta prime edge of sigma, just by the definition of B, is going to be larger than e to the B plus epsilon times the size of the box. And here you use that edge of sigma is larger than this to bound overall by something like e to the 2 beta size of the boundary times e to the beta prime minus b times a minus b minus 2 epsilon or something like that. I may have confused signs, but I mean, it's the same proof as before. So it gives you something like that. And the only way that this is smaller than epsilon, and here this is larger than 1 over epsilon. So now the only way this can happen is if A is smaller or equal to B, okay? And if you think, oh, it proves B larger or equal to A, be smaller or equal to A is that I made a mistake somewhere in the sign and you just have to find it. So this implies that A smaller or equal to B plus 2 epsilon, and that implies that A smaller or equal to B. So it, I mean, it's really the same proof except that you replace probability of being open for an edge by just sigma x, sigma y. I mean, the average of sigma x, sigma y. Okay, that was step one. So now what I need to prove is that if I have that, then the free, I mean, then the, this Gibbs state and this one are equal, which is not completely obvious. So step two, well, step two is to prove that if this is true, this is true for any set A. So for any A even, sigma A beta equals sigma A plus beta. Okay? And here, well, the proof is going to be coming from the following inequality, which is saying that, so it's an inequality due to Leibovitz. And it's saying that sigma A, sigma x, sigma y, plus minus sigma A, sigma x, sigma y, beta in each case, is larger or equal to the following, the absolute value of sigma A plus beta, sigma x, sigma y, beta, minus sigma A, beta, sigma x, sigma y, plus beta. I'm going to prove it, don't worry. But notice that if I have that, then I deduce from this thing, I mean, here it's for arbitrary, so for every A even, and for every x and y, so not necessarily neighbors. So if I have that, then I deduce that first, the spin-spin correlations are equal for any pair of vertices. So how do we, here A may contain x and y. So first thing is that if you take, so first thing, this implies that sigma x, sigma y plus beta equals sigma x, sigma y, beta for any x, y. This was for every edge like that. And the idea is simply if you take, let's do the first step, this is x and y. And if you take x prime and y prime like that, so you take A to be x prime, y prime, and you apply this inequality. Is it the one I want? No, sorry. Of course, I did. I mean, this is, okay, maybe I should say before that, an equivalent way of stating that, sorry, is also that sigma A plus beta minus sigma A beta is larger or equal to sigma A, sigma X, sigma Y, beta plus sigma X, sigma Y, beta minus blah, blah, right? Just apply here this inequality to A union XY, right? Okay, so now in this one, if you apply to X, Y, and to A, which is x prime, y prime, let's say, with these 2 points. What do you get? Why am I confusing everything? Yeah, yeah, you get that this is sigma x, sigma y prime. This is equal to the state with plus, so this term can say, I mean, can factorize with a sigma x, sigma y plus. Here it's sigma x prime sigma y prime plus, so it's equal to sigma x prime sigma y prime. So I get 0 here, larger or equal to sigma x sigma y prime times the same, I mean, minus sigma x sigma y prime times the same thing. Okay? So this, I just write it once because, I mean, this is clear, but the problem is that you have to understand the concept and then you... So this thing is larger or equal to sigma x sigma x prime, sigma y prime plus beta sigma x sigma y beta minus sigma x sigma y prime beta sigma x sigma y beta plus. So here, these two things are equal. So you get 0 on this side. This thing and this thing are equal. So it factorizes, and you get that sigma x sigma y prime plus is equal to sigma x sigma y prime beta. OK? So what did I just prove? I proved that if it's true for neighbors, it's true for any two points at distance 2 of each other. But now you can obviously extend this reasoning to get that it's true for any pair of points. Okay? Once it's true for any pair of points, here you are going to deduce it for any 4 points, simply because you know it for any pair of points, and because on this side you know it for any pair of points. So by taking A of cardinality 2, here you get it for any 4 points, then 6 points, 8 points, and so on. I mean, this is really like a Russian. Like elementary school thing. But, well. Okay? So this Leibovitz inequality implies the result. Now I need to prove to you the Leibovitz inequality. Okay, how do I prove the Leibovitz inequality? Well, in fact, again, we almost already proved it. Why? Notice that exactly as before, the only thing I need to prove is that sigma a, sigma x, sigma y, say lambda n beta plus minus sigma a, sigma x, sigma y, tau lambda n beta is larger or equal to the thing with tau. Why? Because you can just, if I get this inequality, then that I average here on the distribution of the boundary, I mean on the distribution on the complement of, I mean on the spins outside the box, I can replace this by the value for mu, I mean for my measure, for my Gibbs states, lambda. Okay? And then by letting n go to infinity, I will get my bound with the plus state minus the Gibbs state. Okay? So this is sufficient. Implies Leibovitz by averaging on tau and then letting n go to infinity. So the only thing I need is to prove this thing. Well, in fact, this is the first Griffith inequality. It's nothing more than that. It's hidden, but it's there. The reason is the following, is that, I mean, here, what, I mean, it's how you deduce the second Griffith inequality from the first one. How did we do that? We multiplied by the partition function twice. So here, we are going to multiply by the partition function and write the first thing here as a sum of sigma a, sigma x, sigma y, minus here sigma a prime, sigma x prime, sigma y prime, of E to the minus beta h of sigma minus, I mean, plus h of sigma prime. It was when we multiplied by the right thing, we were ending up with this thing, with two copies, sigma and sigma prime here. Okay? Just notice that here, the h are different h. Here is h plus, here is h tau. This is the Hamiltonian with plus boundary condition. This is the Hamiltonian with tau boundary condition. Okay? But otherwise, this is just writing this quantity. So what did we do in the proof of the second Griffith inequality? We said, okay, define omega to be sigma, sigma prime. Right? Okay, and that was equal to the sum over omega of 1 minus omega a, omega x, omega y of sum over sigma of sigma a, sigma x, sigma y. And then we get the e to the minus beta, h of sigma. And here we were getting an h of sigma with some random coupling constant. Right? I mean, some coupling constant that were related to the omega. Well, here it's going to be the same. And the fact that you get tau here instead of plus is irrelevant. You can always say, well, it's with plus boundary condition, except that the coupling between the two is minus one instead of plus one. But if you think about it, in the thing that we use here, the only thing that we use is that the coupling constant of the first guy was larger than the absolute value of the coupling constant of the second one. So I let you think about it. But when you just try it by yourself, because it's a little bit like there, it's much simpler to do by yourself than by following it on a board, and definitely simpler than writing it on a board. So here, this thing really check that this is rewritten as a Hamiltonian with a plus boundary condition, actually, for some random graph, g of omega, but that all the coupling constants here are positive. And in fact, this bound would work if here you would have any coupling constant as long as in absolute value they are smaller or equal to those here. Okay? So you get something like that. And in the Griffiths, there what we said to prove the second Griffiths inequality, we just said, well, this is larger or equal to zero. This is larger or equal to zero. So the whole thing is larger or equal to zero. Okay, good for us, but it's not what we want to prove, right? But the observation that we didn't use is that this is zero if omega a is equal to omega x, omega y. And it's two if omega a is different from omega x, omega y. So this is, in fact, larger or equal to either plus or minus times omega a minus omega x, omega y. If they are equal, I get zero. And if they are different, I get either two or minus two, but it's always smaller or equal to two. Okay? Well, when you have that, this is positive. So that means that this whole thing is larger or equal to the average of, the sum of omega, or of, say, either omega a minus omega xy times this, or minus omega a minus omega xy. Well, once you have said that, just go back, and you actually obtain one of the two things, like you obtain, I guess, this one. If you have with minus, you obtain minus this, which exactly tells you that you are larger or equal to the absolute value. Okay? So it's really the proof from first to second Griffiths, except there is a small twist that we were losing a little bit too much here by just saying this is larger or equal to zero. This is in fact larger or equal to that. Yes?
Do we have a problem with the partition function? Because we
So you see here the partition function is hidden. Like if I take only this thing, I did multiply by sum of a sigma prime, the partition function of a sigma prime. So it's actually, it's really exactly what you want. When you are going to rerun it, it's exactly what you want. Because here you have a product of a guy with plus boundary condition and a guy with tau boundary condition. One is going to take one of the partition functions, the other one. It's really, it's a good question, but it works exactly as you want. This seemingly like technical inequality is actually extremely useful. For instance, it does imply in almost 5 lines that the surface tension of the easing model is positive above beta c, which is something which is extremely difficult to prove. Just, I mean, it's not proved for POTS models, for instance, or for generalization of it. So this is really like a miraculous inequality in some sense. Okay. Well, we are ready to conclude the proof. So last step 3 is that my measure is equal to lambda plus beta plus 1 minus lambda minus beta. Okay? For some lambda. Okay, so in order to prove that, the first thing that you can observe is that, in fact, it's sufficient to prove it for an ergodic Gibbs state. Because there is this abstract theorem saying that the state of Gibbs states is actually a simplex. Every Gibbs state is uniquely, decomposed into a convex combination of ergodic Gibbs states. So assume. Translation invariant, yeah. Assume you are right, yeah, that beta is ergodic. You're entirely right. Okay, so if this guy is ergodic, now what I'm going to define is the symmetric version of this guy, which is going to be, well, defined by the average of x of sigma is equal to x of sigma beta plus x of minus sigma beta. Okay, I just, boldly, one person breaking his leg is sufficient, so what do? I symmetrize my state. Why do I want to do that? Because this new state first thing, still has the property that it's equal to this, which, by the way, also is equal to this. So for any A even, I have this property. But the fact that it's symmetric also gives me for free that this is true for odd. Sigma A sim beta is equal to 0, which is equal to sigma A 0 beta for any A odd. So it's a tiny trick, but this trick allows me to have that every correlation, spin correlation, are coinciding for the symmetric state here and the zero state. Well, that implies automatically that they are equal. Okay. I'm surprised that people are afraid of me. Okay. So this state is equal to this one. But this state is actually one half of the plus and the minus states, which are ergodic. This is very simple to prove. Maybe I didn't prove it, but run the proof that we use for random cluster model. It works perfectly there. So that means that this guy, so by uniqueness of the decomposition, maybe here I should put. By uniqueness of the decomposition, on one side I'm decomposed with a plus and minus states, on the other side I'm decomposed with my measure, my ergodic Gibbs states and its reflection. So that means that my ergodic Gibbs states is either the plus or the minus states. But that immediately tells me that the two only Gibbs states are the plus and the minus states, and therefore any Gibbs states is decomposed as a, yeah.
So actually you proved that without assuming transition invariance, the upper line is true. So you used transition invariance only in the last line.
No, I did use translation invariance before, yes. When I used when I proved exactly the when I rerun the proof of phi 1 equal phi 0, when I said for beta prime smaller than beta, the plus states is smaller or equal.
Whenever you refer to the FK, you say you use transition.
I didn't really refer to the FK, but I run the same proof, and in the proof there was the fact that if A is the average of the plus state and B is the average of the other one, then in the box of size n, the sum of the edge of, I use that the sum of the averages was equal to volume times A, and in the other one, volume times B. And that did use invariance under translation. Yeah. This argument was replaced by the free energy in Leibovitz, but in both cases, you do use this volume against boundary, and that does use invariance under translation. Thank you for the question, because I think it's an very important point. Okay, good. So let's now run the second theorem of the day. So this is the end of the proof. I mean, it's pretty rare that you can actually classify the Gibbs states of It's a difficult question usually, so here in some sense it's nice that for the Ising model, after the work of so many people, you have a nice proof of this. So theorem, the second theorem you see it coming is to prove that the sigma x sigma y plus beta is equal to sigma x sigma y 0 beta for any edge of ZD and any beta. It's always true. And this is a theorem which goes back to Bodinow. And today I'm going to give you the proof of Aran Raoufi, who is a PhD, was a PhD student of mine. He's not dead, but he finished his PhD. And I like very much his proof. First, because it's more robust. And second, it is closer in spirit to, it uses less. So I'm going to run his argument. Okay, so the observation is the following. If you use the switching lemma as I explained yesterday, on Tuesday, sorry, and you use it with edge which is equal to the box plus the edges emanating from it. So you take lambda n, and let's say lambda n bar is the guy with the additional edge emanating from it. If you look at sigma x, sigma y plus lambda n, I'm going to drop the beta, because it's going to be fixed for the whole proof. If I look at this thing, and I use a switching lemma, well, this is expressed in terms of currents in lambda n. This is expressed in terms of currents in lambda n bar. So the difference between the two, if I use a switching lemma, it's going to end up giving me this times the following, the probability in lambda n bar with sources xy times probability in lambda n with no sources of x not connected to y in lambda n. So I use this lemma with h equals lambda n bar and g equals lambda n. And here, and with a equal xy and b equal, I mean, a equal empty set, sorry, and b equal xy. So when you move xy to the top, you have only sources here. But here you get x, I mean, x connected to y in lambda n. So this allows to express this thing here as almost this, except that the currents have the indicator function that x is connected to y in lambda n. So when you do this difference with this thing, you get the probability that x is not connected to y in lambda n. This, I leave it to you as an exercise to use the switching lemma. It's really four lines. Okay? So why is it good? Because if I let n go to infinity, so if n go to infinity, here I get the plus state minus the free one. Here I get something, the plus state average. But here, in some sense, what do I see? Well, I see I have x here. I have y here. What is the only way that x and y are not connected in the box of size n? Well, I have sources at x and y in my first current. Okay? So this first current necessarily has a path between x and y. This we already saw that. Except that this path is in lambda n bar. So that means that this path can do like that in some sense and start from there and do like that. Okay? When I meant connected, I meant connected when really you think of all the vertices outside as being one, as being merged together. So necessarily in the first guy, you need to have that. So for this not to be connected, not only do you need these two paths, but you also need a blocking surface between the two x and y. So you end up with this picture, which is reminiscent of the probability of being pivotal. So assume for a moment, that I can let n go to infinity. Then that implies the following. It implies, so assume that this guy and this guy converge to infinite volume measures, then it would say that x and y are connected to infinity in this kind of infinite volume measures, but not together. Okay? This seems to be a little bit strange. So there is one thing still which is maybe saving us, is that we can think, okay, but x and y play very special roles here. Right? X and y are the sources of the first current. So this is very special. It forces something very strong on x and y. So maybe that changes completely the game. But observe that I can actually here rewrite this here as beta divided by beta times P empty set lambda n bar, P empty set lambda n of the following event, AXY, and AXY is the same event, except that this edge here is open, is just equal to 1 in the first current. So N 1 XY is equal to 1. If I do that, so you agree that this edge XY is necessarily 0 in N1 and N2 for this event to occur. But I can just brutally change the edge to 1 in the first current. Okay? There is a bijection between the configuration with this equal to 1 and the configuration where it's equal to 0. It kills the source XY. XY is not a source anymore. So hence the empty set here. I get a beta here. Notice that here the partition function of this measure was zxy lambda n bar. Now here it's just the empty set lambda n bar. So this is explaining why this term is cancelling. This is exactly the ratio of the two. So this is cancelling. And the point here is that now if you take this converge to say p empty set zd bar and p empty set zd, then our sigma x sigma y plus minus sigma x sigma y 0 is equal to beta times the probability of the event AXY. And there, the good thing about it is that XY here is not involved in the definition here. This is a completely invariant order translation measure. So what did I prove? I proved that this is some kind of percolation measure, which is invariant order translation, and which has the property that if this is not equal to 0, then this probability is positive. So what we are going to do now, we are going to prove that first, you can take the limit. Second, that the limit is invariant order translation and ergodic. And therefore, that here I have a percolation model which has an infinite connected component that looks like what? That looks like an infinite sequence of sausages. Because if this has positive probability to occur, every single edge, by invariance of the translation, has positive probability of having this thing. So by ergodicity, it means that actually a positive density of points have exactly this property. Okay? So the only possible picture for my guy is that there are like finite clusters. And then there is one infinite cluster having this type of property, that it's an infinite sausage of points. The goal is going to be to prove that this is not possible, that it's not possible to have that our percolation process cannot be such that you are just an infinite sausage of things like that, of pieces like that. So it's going to be completely ergodic. Okay? But maybe, I mean, since there is only 10 minutes left, I'm not going to dive into the proof. I'm just going to give you where these things come from. I mean, how did Aran end up trying to do this? Is that the story, so this is a parenthesis. Let's start the proof and do the convergence. It's simpler, actually. Let's do this convergence. So step one, and tomorrow I will tell you the story, but in the middle of the proof where it will make more sense. So step one, we are going to prove that P empty set lambda n bar and P empty set lambda n converge to infinite volume measures, invariant under translations, and ergodic. Like that, we will have the thing ready for tomorrow's ergodic argument. Okay. So first thing that we observe is that, so these are measures on currents, but the measures on currents at the end, they care about what? They care only about parity, and then condition on parity of an edge. The value of the edge is just an independent, I don't remember which type of random variable, but if I say that the thing is even, then the probability of the guy being 0 is 1 over cosh, the probability of the guy being 2 is beta squared over 2 cosh, etc., etc. So we only need to prove that the like push forward by just parity of the measures is converging and ergodic and invariant of the translation, because condition on the parity is just an independent random variable having the right distribution. That the push forward by P, which is taking N and giving the parity, is converging. And invariant of the translation and ergodic. Notice that this push forward is what? It's just the distribution that you will pick on random high temperature expansion. Right? The parity of your current is simply the random the high temperature expansion. So assume, for instance, so let's look at the probability in the box of size n of n restricted to e is even, or ne is even for every e in some set e. Okay? Then, because this is just parity since this is just high temperature expansion, or just you can prove it directly, maybe actually, this is just the cosh of beta to the number of edges in E times the partition function in G minus E divided by the partition function in G. This, I leave it to you as an exercise. Actually, it's very, very simple. So this is the graph where you remove the edges in E, not the vertices, but just the edges, and you divide by Z of G beta. This is just the expression. You can check it by hand. Okay? But that also means that this is cosh of beta to the number of edges, and this, we already used this trick once. If you remove the edges in E, you can also just write it as E to the beta edge, I mean sum for x, y in E of sigma x, sigma y, and with a minus. And G means lambda n here, of course. I already did this trick. I remove the interaction. This is just like removing it from the original thing. Okay, but now this is a nice random variable depending on finitely many spins. So when n tends to infinity, this converges to the infinite volume value. So this converges to e to the minus beta sum for x, y, and e of sigma x sigma y beta. And if I did that for every e, this is already way sufficiently many random variables, and they are consistent to guarantee that the thing converges. Okay? That the whole measure converges. If you do it with lambda n bar, it's just going to change that here it's z plus and z plus. It's going to be plus boundary condition. It's the convergence of the plus state towards what it should converge to. So no difficulty whatsoever there. Invariance of the translation. Well, the invariance of the translation is completely clear because if you take just a translate of E and you run the same argument, here you are going to get a translate of E, but the invariance of the translation of the infinite volume state for easing implies the invariance of the translation of this. So invariance under translation of, let's call it P empty set ZD, follows from invariance under translation of this thing. And same thing if you put this of this one. So the only thing I need to do is to check the ergodicity. And the ergodicity for the phi 1 and phi 0 we checked from mixing, right? So here, what we would like to do is to take, say, n e even for every e in e, intersected with n f even for every f in tau of f, where tau is some translation. And we would like to prove that this converges to the product of the things. Well, here, when you are going to re-express in that, you are going to get exactly that this is a cosh of beta to the e plus tau f. And then we are going to get the average of e to the beta minus beta sum for x, y in e of sigma x, sigma y times e to the minus beta sum for x, y in tau f of sigma x, sigma y, beta. Okay? This is the definition. This is just this thing. If tau is sufficiently big that E and tau f do not intersect, of course. Here I can remove this. And here I can use the mixing of this state to say that this is equal to this. And therefore, then here, I can remove the tau by invariance under translation. So this converges, indeed, when tau tends to infinity, I mean, when the translation is larger, to the right thing. So I did use something here, which is not that clear, is that I did use mixing for this state. But this state is not ergodic. The free state is not ergodic. If beta is, remember, it's this trick that if there is an infinite cluster in phi 0, it has one spin, which is either plus or minus, and that does break the thing. Or another way of putting it is that the free state is one half of the plus and the minus states. If the plus and minus states are not equal, you just prove that it's not ergodic. But the trick is that it's still true that it's ergodic for even random variables. So for random variables which are symmetric by spin flip. Why? Because the measure restricted to even random variable is the same as the plus state, and the plus state is ergodic. Okay? So here, because this is by mixing, but of x and y, by mixing of two even random variables. And there, everything is fine. If I would have done it with the plus, So if this was for ZD, if I did it with ZD bar, then it was even simpler because here it was plus, and these were true ergodic states. But for the free, there is this small twist that it's even. So we prove that this guy is ergodic and invariant of the translation. It exists. So one thing that I encourage you to think about before tomorrow is try to prove that there is a unique infinite cluster when it exists, because this is going to be the key of the proof. It's not difficult to construct measures that have this type of infinite cluster. It's just that these measures have usually infinitely many infinite clusters. Here, the uniqueness is going to allow us to prove that this cannot occur. Okay? And that's what we will do tomorrow. Thank you.